La Squab. I want you to be like, and as winsome and mysterious as Fenella Fielding, that shining model for all modern mermaids, said Lord Horror to the young La Squab. O Rose, thou art sick. The invisible worm that flies in the night, in the howling storm, has found out thy bed of crimson joy, and his dark, secret love does thy life destroy. William Blake. Some people knew me as Angel Face. That was years ago. Now I'm just called La Squab, the prettiest coquette in the business. The young girl twirled her skirt, first to the left, then to the right, her spread feet never leaving the spongy earth of the riverbank. Some people say I was a real wild child, said Squab, her legs crossed, casually leaning against the gnarled bark of Wotan's oak. And in the sense I was like an animal, I was. I had all this uncurbed energy, and I was kind of spastic with my arms and legs going in all directions. When I was really little, people would tell me how skinny I was. Kids called me Skeletor, but I took it as a challenge. I would become a total terror, lifting boys twice my size to prove I was as strong as they were. I was always small-boned, too. Finally, I realised you have to accept who you are. Who you are? The man with the black quiff of yard-high hair sprouting from his otherwise shaven skull adjusted his monocle. Who you are, where you stand, what principles you choose to live by. These are the important things of life. This, Horror said, almost abstractedly. Most of his attention diverted by steering the dolly Fisher through a particularly troubled patch of blue water. Green weeds thick as vile jelly threatened to clog the paddles of his small steamboat. He spent busy minutes cutting free the watery weeds and finally mooring his vessel to a clump of brambles beneath the oak. Yet again, one is ill-used by one's kind heart, Lord Horror said, breathing in the slow pace of the air here. He cocked his head. Now arose a little wind, sounding like drums and fifes amongst the leaves, and he stepped ashore in his scarlet jacket, flap waistcoat and frilled sleeves. A short anchor rope hanging in loose hoops from his thin hands. Sure, I broke the rules a few times, got snozzled once or twice, Squab curtsied to the man, now with his back to her. But I never felt the need to tell Porkies or waste my time in futile rebellion. I occasionally get a strop on, but then, who doesn't? She sniffed and popped a stick of bubble gum in her mouth. Yes, I'm fine, thanks. My life's tickety-boo is very good, thank you. I'm completely blessed, I really am. I didn't ask, Horror said unemotionally, fastening the thick rope about the base of the oak. He glanced quickly at the black-fringed clouds. The roll of distant thunder promised rain. Nor did I wake that snoring sinner. My good child, I very much fear that you're imposing on me. Horror sat down on a grassy mound, popping a wonder-working pill between lips coated gloss black. If so, and distress has driven you to this expedient, make a friend of me, for I am a friend of your blood and can feel for you without disclosing your conduct to anyone. But it must be on the condition that you speak the truth to me. If you deceive me, I think it right to inform you, you will become a history to your bones. In a world where melanin and villainy were commonplace, he was ever on his toes, alert for the action of babblers and vulgar jesters. When you're young, it's easy to see things as us and them. I try to base everything on what's guttural, not societal, Squab said positively. One quality of her own, and not one she'd inherited from her mother, was self-analysis. Yeah. Those whom the gods make great, said Horror, offhandedly rising to his feet, die old. That was written on the wall at Belshazzar's feast. The meaning of do well and my fuddle would come and go like the moon. This morning I've got my favourite face on, laughed Squab. Not for long, and I'm in control. Squab lifted a twig and poked in a gopher hole. I move forward towards a goal or a wish or a desire. I do is active state. It's a positive affirmation. She glanced sideways. Horace Coxcomb was moving like branches in a squall. She said, there's no fear. Things are fine and peaceful. Not for long they won't be. Squab made her way to a slab of stone and sat down. Rose brambles tumbled on all sides of her. For just a moment, Horror was quite taken by the sight. He ruminated that somewhere between the first primrose and the last sweet-scented pheasant's eye, summer was here. The time when the involuntary thoughts of romantics turned to roses. Roses are part of the English summer psyche, which marks the pinnacle of the turning year. Though to many, Horror mused, roses were an unwelcome sight, as bad as dwarf conifers, culpat heathers, and constipated hebes and potentillas. Personally, Horror believes that roses were appetizing horticultural whores. There was something overtly feminine and sexual about their velvety overlapping petals.